currently, Doug is the recipient of the Sloan Fellowship. This is possibly the world's most prestigious fellowship available to early career faculties. An indication of its prestige is that 23 of its recipients have gone on to win Nobel Prizes. So, no pressure, mate. Doug also, if you want to know more about him, is very, very good at promoting some of his work through video. So if you go onto his website, there's a section on film, and there's a whole suite of little four-minute snippets about important science that he does. It's a very good way to get a good, rounded idea of what he's getting up to in a very short amount of time. He's also been featured in the Washington Post, Nat Geo, BBC. You're giving an interview at UPR?
By somebody here.
While he was here.
Yeah.
So without further ado, and we'd love for you to come and meet with him this evening as well.
Thank you. Thank you. Can you guys all hear me okay?
Yeah.
Okay. I think that, okay, awesome. That was a very overly kind introduction. I appreciate it. If you do go on the video page, you'll see that indeed there's a reason I'm a scientist and not an actor. I look terrible on film. So I understand and excited that this may be a mix of both people from the public as well as scientists here from Utah State. So where I'd like to sort of start is maybe answering an important question, which was a question that my Uber driver put to me this morning at 3:40 a.m. And his question was, okay, wait, you're going to Utah, but you're a marine biologist. What are you talking about the oceans for in Utah? So for a lot of you that are here in the scientific community, you have dozens of answers, and there are sort of short answers and long answers to that question. Let's just collectively answer a short version of that together. And to do that, what I'd like you to do is start by closing your eyes. You guys are, some of you, as bad as my four-year-old at this exercise. I see you. If you can, please take one breath. Okay, exhale. And one more breath. Excellent. You may open your eyes. So that second breath that you took came from the oceans. So that's the short answer. There are lots of ways to go about quantifying the contribution of oceans to our life, but about 50% of the oxygen that's on our planet comes from microscopic algae that are in the oceans. These are phytoplankton, right? So a question an exhibition that reminds us that something as essential as the oxygen that we're breathing in Utah makes a conversation about the oceans germane here as it would in coastal California, as it would in Siberia, right? So there are longer answers, and we can sort of dive into economic values, social values, nutritional values of the oceans, but I think it's quite clear that our fate, our history are linked to the oceans, and in important ways, our future is also linked to the oceans, no matter where we are on the planet. The motif for the science that I sort of want to take us on a journey on and through tonight is a motif that comes from a Norse legend. This is Jormungand. Some of you perhaps have heard this tale before, but the story in a nutshell is that there's this thing, a malevolent serpent that's cruising around the land causing all kinds of problems. People decide that they don't really want to deal with this thing anymore, so they push it into the oceans. A snake is not supposed to do well in the oceans. It's supposed to, it's not supposed to thrive. This particular serpent did well in the oceans. It in fact did remarkably well in the oceans, and it thrived. Ate up a lot of stuff in the oceans, grew to a massive size, grew so large that it actually encircled the planet. So the head of this serpent latched onto the tail of the serpent, and in this tale, in this myth, it's said that that latching on of the head to the tail of Jormungand created a kind of tenuous stability that kept Middle Earth from falling apart. So we'll unpack and reconnect with this a couple different points in the talk. But the first thing that I think is that is important to draw out of this symbolism, this motif, is that in some ways it reminds me of man, of humans' own interaction or journey with the oceans. We weren't pushed into the oceans, but we jumped. We weren't supposed to make it in the oceans, but we did. We made it in a really big way, in terms of our ecological impact on our global oceans. And the reason that we were so successful there as a terrestrial species, as a species that is, by our biology, constructed to be successful in this domain on land, the reason we were so successful in the oceans is the reason we're successful in so many different walks of ecological life, which is because we're good at adapting and developing new technologies. So the technologies that we adapted for marine harvest and interaction with marine biodiversity got us to become hunters, harvesters, fishers in the deepest parts of the oceans, into the farthest reaches of the oceans, and extended our impact truly to, as I say, to a global level. And the sort of global impact that we've had, ecologically speaking, on our oceans, I think, is sort of well represented in a figure like this. This is a figure that has some headness and some tailness of Jormungand as well. And it's a figure that, you know, in this sort of idea that a picture tells a lot of a thousand words, it is for me many thousands of words. It looks like a map. But it's actually not a map. This is a spatial plot of data. This is data that comes from sensors that are attached to fishing vessels. We sort of tapped into this big data stream of sensor data coming from the global fishing fleet. We processed it through a bunch of different kinds of behavioral processing algorithms and created this behavior map for where fishing is happening on our global oceans. It looks like a map because we are using our oceans with such high intensity that we're reverse engineering the boundaries of our continents. That's the only space where you don't see fishing in the oceans is on dry land, right? That is how intense the ecological footprint of humanity in this one domain, fishing, is on our oceans. So indeed, we are a very powerful ecological force in the sea. I want to sort of leave some of those thoughts behind us in lieu for a journey through some science that's near and dear to my heart and head about the biology of extinction. And many of you are quite aware that that extinction is not something new here on the planet, that there have been quite a number of mass extinctions. Typically, paleobiologists recognize five mass extinctions in Earth's history, and I mean, these are big events. This is not trivial stuff in terms of the deep history of life on the planet. This event, for example, the Permo-Triassic extinction, sometimes referred to as the Great Dying. This is a event where in the oceans about 95% of the species went extinct. That's bad. Okay. The KPG, the Cretaceous Paleogene extinction. This is the one my four-year-old hates, right? Everyone knows why, because he loves dinosaurs. This is when a 10-kilometer-wide asteroid struck our planet, and it impacted the planet with the same energy as about a million nuclear bombs going off, right? Also, clearly bad, right? That was a bad day for life on our planet. So we have seen a lot of these very impactful changes in the deep history of biology here on Earth. Of interest to me as an ecologist is thinking not so much about where we went, but where we're going with patterns of life. Are conversations by colleagues that are summarizing threat and patterns of extinction now on the planet around us, and are coming towards a conclusion that we may be building up towards a sixth mass extinction. We've seen those five in the past. Perhaps we are building up towards a sixth mass extinction. And the data that powers this conversation about a sixth mass extinction largely comes from terrestrial species. The idea is that usually you rate or search for criteria for mass extinction based on the rate of extinctions per unit time. A lot of different ways to do this, but when scientists look at things like mammals, birds, amphibians, reptiles, we see a pickup in the rate of extinction in recent time, and these are extinctions now in the last 500 or so years that that we're involved in. This story of a possible sixth mass extinction, as I said, has been largely powered by a scientific community that's using data from land, terrestrial data. The question that I want to answer together and the question that I was really interested in is a sixth mass extinction, in effect, leaking into our oceans? So are we seeing a sixth mass extinction begin to manifest themselves in the global oceans the same way that it appears to be manifesting itself on life around us now? So to answer that question, which is sort of, again, a forward-looking question, I do want us to sort of look backward for a moment in time. We're going to go back a little ways. We're going to go back about 50,000 years, and we'll look at extinctions that are associated with humans in this 50,000-year or so record. I'll show you first extinctions here on the screen that happened on land. Those are coded in green. You can see first there's a lot of green data on that plot. There is a lot of extinction that has happened on land in this 50,000-year history. Another interesting attribute to me is this pulse nature of this extinction. Humanity arrives to Australia, and you see a pulse of extinction. We, as a species, get to the Americas, and you see a pulse of extinction. We cruise on, and in the last 500 years or so, we're about everywhere on this planet, and that's where you see this gigantic green bar really begin to show up in this extinction history. And that is the sort of raw material that powers these conversations about a sixth mass extinction occurring on land. That's land. We sort of already are aware of that story. What's the deal with the oceans? So if we throw in marine extinctions, these are, again, marine animal extinctions, same time period, walk ourselves back to about 50,000 years, we see just silence on this record until we get to just the past 500 years. And we see the first blip occurring on the extinction record in our oceans. If you just do the simple math of tallying up the sort of body count of extinction on land and in the oceans in the last 500 years, you have approximately 514 or so terrestrial extinctions that occurred on land. Same time period, about 15 marine animal extinctions. And we're looking at the images of what I sometimes call the oceans 15, the 15 marine animal extinctions that have occurred in the oceans. Another viewpoint of this same phenomenon, contrasting this extinction history on land and sea, we see here. This is just a cumulative plot of extinctions in land in green and oceans in blue. Again, a very different kind of history here with this rather unpleasant, disconcerting arc upwards in extinctions on land. And the contrast, the contrary, true for the oceans. We see this delightful flat line for extinctions in recent history in our oceans. So, a bit of happy news in a way. It seems that we may be building towards a sixth mass extinction on land, but there is a very different answer coming at us from the oceans. There's a lot to learn if we dive a little bit deeper in unpacking some of this pattern. For example, we can look not just at species that have been driven extinct in the oceans, but species that may be sitting on the brink of extinction, and see where some of the risk or endangerment sits relative to different kinds of taxonomic groups that that inhabit the oceans. And there's a lot to learn that maybe helps us predict where risk lies and helps us sort of mount strategic interventions to make sure more extinction doesn't happen, to make sure that lovely flat line in the ocean stays nice and flat. Some of the patterns that I thought were quite informative. First, on this side of the graph, sort of sitting in this haze of green, are species in the oceans that have at some point during their life history contact with land. Hanging out over here in this light blue space are species that are exclusively aquatic. You can get at least a qualitative sense, the same is true quantitatively, that species that put a flipper or put a webbed foot on land during some point in their life history have more risk. There's more red on this section of our graph. That makes sense, right? So if we are a driver of extinction, a principal driver of extinction in the modern era, if you get closer to us, you find yourself in more trouble, right? Sometimes the obvious, though, can be quite informative. Other things that can be learned, qualitative patterns of interest, when you compare marine rayfin fishes, which have a very different life history, can be much more productive and prolific than cartilaginous fishes, things like sharks and rays. You see that our sharks and rays, our cartilaginous fishes, which have much slower life histories, less offspring, slower takes a lot longer to get to maturity, that they are in a higher risk category. Another important thing here, when you begin to look for where risk lies, is the large amount of gray and black on this graph. That's the number of species that have not yet been reviewed by international experts that tell us something about their risk, or that reviewers have sat down and said, geez, there's just no data. This is a data deficient species. That's always important as we sort of make conclusions about extinction to have in the back of our minds. In the oceans, there is a lot of unknown. There's a lot of unknown about what risk groups are facing, particularly for our invertebrates, right? And these are not obscure things like copepods. We don't know what a lot of obscure things like copepods, what risks they're facing. But these are important foundation species like coral reefs. That we have less information than we ought to on what risk they are facing in our oceans as well. Okay, so we have this sense that in the here and now, if you look at this currency for extinction, we're in better shape in the oceans, and that is a good news to kind of celebrate, right? I think sometimes scientists get portrayed for being doom and gloom types. I had no idea what I was going to find when I went through and did some of this accounting for extinction on land and the sea. I was delighted to find, happily surprised to find, that things right now look very good in the oceans. But I think there's an important exercise for us to think about where we're headed. This gives us a sort of an assay of present health, at least in terms of the currency of the extinction for fauna, for life in the oceans. But where are we going from here? For that, to try to figure out where we're going, I'd like to reach even further back in time. This is a data set and an exercise that I did with colleagues at Stanford that are paleobiologists. They had this amazing data set where they had information on what species went extinct and what kinds of species went extinct, and what rates of species went extinct over a much longer time period. We're marching back here to about 50, 60, 70 million years ago. That takes us back to the edge of the last mass extinction, to the KPG boundary, right, when the dinosaurs went extinct. And you can see the signal for that last mass extinction there on this graph, right, in terms of percent genus extinctions. I'm plotting here percent genus extinctions for mollusks and for vertebrates. There's about 2,000 or so species in this database. We see at the end of that last mass extinction a clear presence for it in this extinction plot, and then things kind of mellow out, and we have some ups and some downs over time, over this 50 million or so years. But by and large, there's that answer again, that things are looking okay in the oceans. Well, one way to get at where we might be going is to take portraits of risk of the kind that I just showed you, all of the species where we have assigned different kind of risk categories for, sort of, the ecological analog of like yellow, green, and red for endangerment for different species. And if we take those, there's lots of ways to do this, but if we take species that are at high risk of going extinction and we create some scenarios, some hypotheses, and say, well, what if everything that was in the oceans that scientists and experts are telling us are just about to go extinct, what if they all went extinct? What would that look like? And there are many flavors of like what would that look like, different scenarios you can build depending on how you want to sort of parse what sort of risk categories and risk assignments you want to push towards extinction in these hypotheticals. Let's just take a mid-range scenario here. What we do is we take species at high risk of extinction, we make them go hypothetically extinct. For all the species that we don't know, don't have any information on their risk categories, we map the same vulnerability or likelihood for extinction for our known species onto our unknown species. For mollusks and vertebrates, if you do that, that takes you here. That takes you to a future that looks uncomfortably like this past. That takes us to a future that could look and could approximate percent genus extinction rates that are on par with some of those that we saw in the oceans during the last mass extinction that the oceans experienced. I was very satisfied with my good news, but it seems that I couldn't hang on to it too long, that there's at least some tenuous nature, that there's a little fragility to that good news for the oceans, which is to say that if we sort of continue to steer a pathway forward of business as usual in the oceans, that and if indeed we push all the species that our experts are saying could go extinct, if they indeed went extinct, we could create a future for the oceans that we don't want. We could take this delightful flatline of extinction in the oceans and we could crank it up to a place that looks far too much like catch-up for where extinction is at for life on land. So we don't want that to happen, right? The whole, yes, thumbs up, awesome. Yeah, the neat thing about the oceans is we don't have to let that happen. Very often in conservation biology and very often in management, we're sort of triaging, we're putting fires out and we're trying to deal with species that either just went extinct or just about there, and you feel like you're really a doctor attending to a hospital of patients that are in serious, serious trouble. In this instance, in the oceans, you have a really amazing opportunity to think about thinking about prospective tools not to create that kind of future, which is really optimistic and really exciting. So if we all are in agreement that we don't want to go from here to there, how do we prevent ourselves from doing that? For me, one of the things that I thought was really informative was to think about this space. So what happened when things were kind of cozy and comfy with the extinction on land, and then the slope of this line changed? When did it change? Why did it change? What happened there? Because maybe there's something to learn from that experiment that ran its course once with extinction on land that we can learn from and apply if we're indeed running this experiment again, potentially in the oceans. So these years you'll recognize as being about the time of the Industrial Revolution on land. I want to lay out for you a hypothesis. We can kick it around together and examine it, maybe over beers at 1784 North or wherever we're going. but let me lay out for you what I think may have happened on land when we ran this experiment the first time around, and think about whether there's anything to learn from that and whether there's any possibilities of finding some resonance in that experiment for the situation in the oceans. So we have been impacting species in the oceans for an awfully long we've been impacting species in the oceans as well as on land. We've been impacting species on land for a long, long time. We sort of saw that in some of our first plots of extinction. We've been driving species extinct for at least 50,000 years or so. But something very fundamental changed, in my view, of our relationship with wildlife and ecosystems about the time of the Industrial Revolution. So the sort of first relationship we had with wildlife and the first inroads we had for extinction were when we hunted animals directly. So that was us out there on the savanna, on the grasslands of North America, elsewhere, with spears, bows and arrows, spear throwers, whatever, hunting mammoths and ground sloths and saber-toothed tigers and short-faced bears and all of these things, either for products that we would use or to make sure they didn't eat us or our kids or whatever, right? And we were so good at that, using these simple technologies, that we drove a good number of those species extinct. But then, as I'm suggesting, something changed in our relationship with impacting wildlife, with our relationship with the environment about the time of the Industrial Revolution on land. And that, for me, is that we switched in a big way globally as a species from hunting animals to hunting their homes. That is, we began modifying habitats, changing, degrading, altering habitats in a big way that we hadn't done before. And I think that really changed the dynamic of extinction. The way I get my head around it is I think of, well, you know, if we're really good and unregulated hunters, perhaps if we, you know, if we had no common sense and we just kept going at it, we could potentially drive a species of deer extinct, right? Well, if you switch to hunting a forest, of course, the forest is home to deer, but it's home to hundreds of other species. When we switch to hunting ecosystems, we may drive a whole lot more species extinct when we enter that phase of shifting, degrading, altering habitats. And I do think that fundamentally shifted about the time that we began using space in more ambitious ways to build out cities, to build out factories, to bring energy and fuel into make modern life around us. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. Of course, I appreciate all the things that happened in a big way during the Industrial Revolution, but I think in terms of ecological history, it is potentially an observation of note that's of importance to this conversation about the biology of extinction. So we started hunting animals, and then we started hunting ecosystems. Perhaps that changed the game for extinction on land. Where are we at in the oceans in this potential sequence? We've been hunting animals in the oceans for a long time. We're fishing hooks that are 50,000 or so years old. So we've been in the business of being fishermen in the oceans for about as long as we've been in the business of doing anything. The question for me is, okay, is there any evidence that we may be in the oceans shifting towards a kind of industrial revolution, an industrial revolution that would change our relationship from hunting species to changing their space, to hunting ocean homes? Now, at first pass, as I was thinking through this, I thought, well, that can't be so. We're just out there fishing. There's nothing. We're not building factories. We're not building cities. But as I began to work through data sets, and I normally just work on data sets of fish eat or how many fish there are, I began looking at data sets about us. And I want to share some of those data sets with you that I think are good food for thought, for thinking about potential for us shifting our relationship with the oceans and shifting our relationship with ocean space and shifting our relationship with ocean space in a way that may have some connections to this conversation about industrial revolutions, space use, and extinction. So some patterns of change in the oceans. First of all, we never mined in the oceans before. It was the thing of science fiction. We made movies about it and that sort of thing. But it is now a matter of science and not a matter of science fiction. We've gazetted over 1 million square kilometers of ocean in marine mining claims, and we're beginning to explore those claims, and probably we'll have our first commercial scale extraction of minerals in the ocean that goes online this year, next year, certainly in the next several years. Here's just a view of the growth of these mining contract claim areas in our oceans. And this one's a little complicated, right? Because why are we doing that? We're searching for minerals that we use a lot in our lives, that I have in my iPhone, that I have on my computer. These are often rare earth elements that, as the name suggests, we're running out on land, and so we're beginning to look for them in the oceans, using some pretty interesting tools, like 300-ton mining machines that are essentially waterproof robots that can go down to the deepest parts of the oceans and mine out these resources. Well, that would be a very different use for the oceans, and that would be a use that certainly impacts space differently. How about another one? We are beginning to build power plants in our oceans. So we're harvesting wind energy, and we're harvesting tidal energy and wave energy, ocean geothermal energy, in a big way, and a lot of projects both here in the United States and even more actively elsewhere on our planet. This is just a growth, a plot of the exponential growth. It harkens, at least in tendency, to the same plot for growth that we saw for the extension of seabed mining claims. So this is an interesting new form of human activity and human use of the oceans. Now, anyone who knows anything about what we're doing to faunal futures probably is thinking here, well, okay, this is energy, but this is pretty low carbon energy, and climate change is going to come online and impact the oceans in a big way. It's causing the oceans to become hotter, more acidic, and harder to breathe in. You don't need a marine scientist to tell you that sucks for ocean life if it's hotter, more acidic, and harder to breathe in, right? So this is a complication in terms of it putting a lot more human hardware in the spaces that ocean fauna exist in, but it's also something that we need to be thinking about constructively because it is a low-carbon form of energy. Complicated, again, I guess, is my summary. Traffic is increasing in our oceans as well. It's increasing in Salt Lake City. If you think it's bad, come to my hometown of LA. It's increasing in the oceans in a big way. This is a now increasingly familiar exponential curve for traffic in our oceans. Traffic in the oceans brings many of the same problems that traffic on land brings in terms of transit of invasive species, in terms of pollution, be that chemical pollution or noise pollution. So it's a major source of concern. We even have roadkill in our oceans. Ed mentioned, this applied change initiative, one of the things we're working on is trying to reduce the number of collisions that ships like this have with whales. This one, no less complicated. Everything that I'm wearing very likely came in on ships like this. So it's an important part of our global commerce, but it's an important change for human presence in our oceans as well. One last one for us to sort of intellectually meditate on here together, farming in the oceans. We've been hunters in the oceans for a long time, as I said, but we're beginning to become farmers in the oceans in a big way as well. 2014 was the first year ever in which humanity, people on our planet, ate more fish that came from farms than came from the wild. I mean, just think on that for a moment, right? That's huge. That's a transformative event. That's as big in the oceans as the event on land when we stopped hunting our dinner from forests and from savannas and started growing it at home. We're seeing that transition beginning now underwater in the oceans, and that will change the game for our impact in the oceans. This is just a plot for shrimp aquaculture. This same sort of traces could be replicated for all kinds of different aquaculture and mariculture products in our oceans. So an explosive growth of new types of farming that are happening in our global oceans. If you sort of put these pieces and a dozen other different traces of differing and evolving human use in our oceans, for me, it begins to create a suggestion that maybe something is changing in the oceans. Maybe we are moving towards a future that perhaps recreates some essence of the history of the way that we interacted with ecosystems and wildlife on land. Maybe we are slowly building, bit by bit, towards something that could look like an industrial revolution in the oceans. Now, this is, you know, a challenge for somebody who's, an ecologist who usually, when I get ambitious, I think about trying to make projections for what a population is going to do in 5 years' time. I'm not talking about an industrial revolution in the oceans manifesting itself next year, this decade. I'm talking about what is our future for the oceans going to look like in the next 100 years. And that's where I think I want to have you guys in that sort of headspace. Are these patterns indicative of long-term changes in the oceans that may matter for ocean biodiversity and extinction? Okay, so if it's possible that we may be changing how we're using the oceans, and if it's possible that there could be some interactions we want to be aware of with that change, how that shapes a future of extinction, what tools do we have at our disposal to engage this industrial revolution more thoughtfully? In other words, how can we make this go down better in the oceans than it did on land? There's a lot of really interesting tools that we can draw into our portfolio as conservation biologists, as ecosystem managers, and put to work towards shaping and engaging this industrial revolution if it's beginning to shape up, and engaging it before it shapes up constructively. Here's one example. We all have a sense that parks work for wildlife on land. If you want to see elk or deer or a bear, right? You put the kids in the car and you drive them to a national park, right? And it's quite easy to see them in that space. The same thing works for underwater versions of interesting hybrid of deer and elk and bear. The underwater versions of those same large fauna profit inside parks in our oceans. Of course, the nature of building parks under the sea is quite different because the biology of life in our oceans is fundamentally different from biology of life on land. There's only so far you can take that analogy between, say, deer and parrotfish. Just one thing to highlight before we jump too far on here is that in terms of park creation in the oceans, we're well behind the curve of where we promised we should be and well behind the curve of where we are on land. We're about 12 to 15% of, depending on how you define things, of our terrestrial biome of the land world that has been included in parks. And we're in the most ambitious form at about 5% of our oceans that are protected. So how do we maybe get closer to catching up and getting these parks in the oceans? How do we make them effective, and how do we personalize them to the biology of the oceans? That point about personalizing the biology of the oceans, one thing that is perhaps obvious, but a fundamental importance when you customize a park for being placed in the oceans is that ocean animals use more space. This is intuitive. Sometimes scientists will spend years of their life trying to create plots that tell you something that a farmer or a fisherman or any other smart person could tell you, return a very intuitive answer. That's what this plot is about. Fortunately, not years of my life, but a large chunk. collecting thousands of data points on home range size for different species of terrestrial and marine animals, laying them side by side, standardizing by body size, and then seeing if indeed it's true that ocean animals use and require more space than terrestrial animals when you standardize by body size. And it seems that, by and large, it is the case that you'll see this blue curve sit above that green curve. That makes sense. Like if you take a lizard and you match it up to an anchovy, the anchovy will use a lot more space than the lizard uses, and that sort of replicates itself from whales down to tiny marine invertebrates. So ocean animals need more space. That means that we need bigger parks for them under the sea if we're going to actually use these parks as tools for guiding against extinction. Now here's an interesting thing. Normally the way that talks like this go down is you say we need bigger parks, and you know, you sort of hope that there's somebody out in the policy arena that's listening to that, and you know, it may take decades or centuries to sort of occur, whatever your prescription is. In the oceans, a very interesting thing has happened. We actually have seen this explosive change towards having larger parks, probably exactly what we need to sort of guard against extinction. And it's happening so fast that we can't even get our scientific or our management heads and hats around this. So look here at what I sometimes call the ocean megapark revolution. The blue line here is the mean size, the average size of parks in the ocean, marine protected areas. We're sort of cruising along at these like boutique size protected areas, golf course size protected areas, and then something happens about here where, holy cow, we end up with ocean parks that are bigger than the state of California, literally bigger than the state of California. And that's big, and that's different, and that's exciting, as I said, in terms of customizing these things effectively to ocean life and ocean protection. But it also created a real problem, is what I'm suggesting. It created a real problem because, think about this, like, California's a pretty big state, right? We all think of a national park like Yosemite as being a pretty big park, pretty hard to look after with what resources we have. Think how hard it would be to look after a space as big as the state of California with the resources that some of our management agencies have right now, right? That's the happy problem that we've created for ourselves in the oceans now. This statement about megaparks is grossly outdated. In just 2 years, we're now closer to about twice that number of megaparks that are over 1,000 kilometers squared in space. So what do? We have these gigantic parks. We don't want them just to be meaningful on we don't want them just to be on paper, because that doesn't help biodiversity. We want to actually have them work for the purposes they're intended to work, to look after wildlife. So I don't think the answer is putting more boats on the water. I don't think it's putting more planes on the water. I'm not even sure, we like to play around with drones as everyone does. I don't think it's drones. I think it's space. I think the way to make this work, these new tools that we have sort of fortuitously given to us via this change in policy, this mega park revolution, I think the way to make those actually meaningful is through space. Another revolution. I sometimes see nothing but revolutions around me, but it's an exciting time to be an ecologist. Another revolution in technology is in Earth observation. There is an increasingly dense constellation of micro nano satellites that are being deployed encircling our planet, allowing us to look and watch our planet with incredibly high resolution, and to detect signals that are coming off our planet in some of the most remote parts of our planet in ways that we weren't able to do years ago, let alone a decade ago. And I think this is gonna be very empowering for looking after these ocean spaces and biodiversity in those spaces. This is bringing to life the data that we started with, that first plot about sensor data coming off fishing boats. This constellation of nano satellites, one thing that at least one brand of those satellites does is it picks up that sensor data that I mentioned. All of these sensors that fishing boats carry, it brings in billions of data points from those fishing boats in the most remote parts of the planet. As we process that, as I say, through these different behavioral algorithms that say, okay, well, a purse seiner looks like this, a longliner looks like this behaviorally, where are they in the oceans, is that we get these high-resolution views of, for the first time ever, where fishing is happening in the oceans. We basically turned the light switch on for our understanding for how humans are using the oceans, and we did that literally about 2 years ago, right? That can be really helpful for enforcing, managing, observing these parks and human use of these parks. Here's an example. This is a very large marine protected area out in the Central Pacific where I do a bit of my work. And this is a view of the density of fishing activity. Red means more activity inside the park 6 months before closure. It closed on January 1st of 2015. We looked back 6 months after the closure of the park, and we actually saw that things really quieted down. In fact, in this park, people were obeying the laws. People were doing exactly what the country, in this case Kiribati, wanted to be happening in this. And we, you know, just by using these new tools for processing big data and creatively engaging these sensors that are surrounding our planet, we were able to look down and enforce, or at least look down and observe what was happening in this space. You can see a couple errant cells here, some activity, fishing activity inside these this park. The group that I work with as partners at some NGOs and Google, they took data from those from the cells that weren't supposed to be in there after closure. They sent that down to the government. The government folded this into this enforcement case they're building against these illegal, this one illegal fishing boat that was inside the protected area when it shouldn't be, and they ended up getting $1 million settlement from this large industrial fisher that shouldn't have been there. So a really kind of happy success story of how you can use new data and use it thoughtfully to think about protecting large spaces in our oceans more responsibly. An exciting thing that's also happening in our oceans is that the United Nations now is engaged in a process of thinking about a new treaty for biodiversity in high seas. High seas are our international waters that are the biggest part of our oceans, probably the biggest ecosystem arguably on the planet. It's 67% of our oceans is outside of any one nation's boundary, right? There's sort of no man's land of the oceans. Nothing like it really on land, but this huge part of our planet that is, the fish there belong to me, to you, to my kids, everyone. And the United Nations, as I say, has sat down and said, we need a new kind of treaty to deal with a biodiversity out there in this sort of no man's land, because we don't have enough regulation to sort of coordinate a healthy and sustainable future for all sorts of resources out there, from tuna to turtles. It used to be that we couldn't see what was happening out there, and so what's the point of making a treaty when you can't actually see what's going on in the global oceans? These sensors allow us for the first time to be able to track behavior out there and maybe empower a group like the United Nations to do something more meaningful for, again, the largest ecosystem on our planet. You can begin to learn all kinds of interesting things. Another sampling of activity and information that you can derive from these the sensors and this data is I'd always had this intuition, and many people in fisheries have this intuition that slightly unlike at least some sectors of food harvest and resource extraction in the developing world and in poorer nations on our planet, that much of the harvest of fish is happening from by wealthy nations. Having a complete view of who's out there fishing, I could actually answer this question. And interestingly, it does turn out that about 78% of the large-scale fishing that happens in poor countries is being administered by wealthy countries, which just opens up, I think, an exciting possibility when you have a number like that in front of you to start thinking about, well, is this a good thing? Is this a bad thing? What does this mean for wealth transfer? What does this mean about food futures for a part of the planet that we want to keep stable and healthy? Again, data helps us, I think, both open those conversations and power those conversations in meaningful ways. One last example of what you can do with data sources like this, that the mining, the ocean mining data. One of the reasons, how many people have ever heard of ocean mining before in a serious way? Okay, so a handful, but perhaps not far from a majority of people. And that's the case, is that the oceans are out of sight, out of mind. One of the things that we did just to help people get involved in the conversation, learn more about it, see where it's happening, and begin to sort of do science around where it's happening, is use the same suite of sensors to map where prospecting for mining is happening in the oceans. And we run this website now that when I should be doing things like writing more papers, building websites to track where mining is beginning in our oceans. But a very empowering bit of data for thinking about management of future and management of activity that may impact biodiversity futures. Another interesting thing we can do with this sensor data is combine stories of people with stories of things like sharks. So we can bring sharks and humans into the Internet of Things because we're able to put sensors on people, as I said. We're also able to put sensors on sharks. This is an example of a sensor that my lab sticks on sharks, and it's a satellite GPS transmitter, so when the shark breaks the surface, kind of like Jaws, it kicks off the signal. We're able to see, while I'm drinking coffee in Santa Barbara, exactly where these sharks are popping up. And I get their ecological story of what parts of the oceans they use, they transit, what resources they're using, or at least what space they're likely pulling resources out of. These white dots are the shark's story of what ocean they're using. The color is the fisherman's story of what parts of the ocean they're using. And so you can hybridize these stories for these two important marine predators, sharks and us. And you can get to a better place for planning a future that works for sharks and works for us. So another, I think, powerful use of these kinds of technologies. A different set of technologies. You can't see everything from space. We need to have new kinds of sensors that get us into understanding patterns of decline, use, and ecology of some of these at-risk species underwater as well. This is something called an acoustic camera that we've adopted in our lab for trying to track things at-risk species like sharks and manta rays. This is a parade of manta rays going back and forth among in front of a reef pass that we're able to use to try to understand more about habitat connectivity and what habitats are really important to some of these endangered marine animals. So another line of technological insight here. The point with laying out what you can do for sticking sensors underwater, sticking sensors on the back of sharks, sticking sensors in space, sticking sensors on fishing boats is that I always invite my four-year-old to talks too. He's actually much better behaved than mine. The point that we started with was that technology has got us into the ocean and into business impacting the oceans in a big way. It may well be that the capacity to bite our tail, if you will, may also be technology. This balancing force that prevented Jormungand from destroying the planet, this head versus tail biting thing, may be for an ocean future, this balancing force of technology getting us farther in the oceans, helping us to impact new habitats, new spaces in new ways. We're also able to see it, to document it, to study it, to zone it, to plan it out more effectively than we've ever been able to do before. And why does this matter? I always make my students sort of answer a why question towards the end of their talks. Why do we even care about any of this? And I'll do the same. Why would we care about preventing? There seem to be some tacit agreement that we don't want to be building towards a marine extinction, mass extinction in our oceans. Why not? Why does that matter to us, right? It's clear that it will have an impact on a lot of important species and a lot of our biodiversity portfolio on our planet. These sort of uncharismatic aqua and purple squares are composites of some of the most amazing animals on our planet, right? One of the species that, when I built this hypothetical, when I pushed species off this extinction cliff, was, for example, blue whales, right? This is an animal that is the largest animal that's ever lived on our planet. It's bigger than any of the dinosaurs, has a heart the size of a car. It's something you could swim right into if you're a scuba diver into its aorta, right? That's a pretty special species, and it's not something we want to lose to the planet. But it's not about being a whale hugger. It's not just about it's not just about losing species of other planet. Avoiding these futures is a very selfish activity as well. Some of the research that we've got engaged in that has shown some really interesting and intricate and direct connections between futures for biodiversity in our oceans and our own well-being. This is just one map, for example, that shows a kind of interesting interaction between fish declines, how fish declines made it harder to catch fish and required more labor, However, because the context this was happening in West Africa and Southeast Asia, there was not an increase in price for these fish. So you had to get this labor through alternative cheap labor sources. In both of these different regions, that cheap labor source was child labor. And so you ended up with this scenario where a fisheries decline was causing increase in child labor to deal with continuing to sustain harvest for a declining wildlife resource. So there are these feedbacks where declines in wildlife that are part of, again, those composite sort of lifeless dots can mean quite a great deal to us and quite a great deal to humanity and well-being on our planet. They also mean quite a lot in terms of the raw currency of nutrition. Fish are beautiful. I like snorkeling with them. I'm impressed by them. I think they're complex and pretty. They're also delicious, right? And they're swimming packets of beautiful nutrients, right? They're some of the most nutritious food on our planet. And if we actually sit down to try to get at the currency by which they not only influence, you know, human well-being, but nutritional well-being, you get some pretty impactful answers. This is a collaboration with guys we did at Harvard trying to actually do the exercise of figuring out, well, what if trajectories of fish decline and overfishing continued? What would that actually mean for some of the most important nutrients that control and prevent populations, particularly in developing parts of the world, from being one step away from diseases associated with malnutrition? What we found was that if we continue on these trajectories of fish decline in our oceans, almost 845 million people on our planet would be pushed across a boundary where they're deficient for core micronutrients, which prevent them from experiencing diseases of malnutrition. So you have, you know, the whales, if that resonates, that is a good why we should prevent this from happening. You have certainly lots of issues associated with human well-being on the social front, on the political front, and it is hitting as close to home as our dinner plates. So by way of summary, sort of trying to stitch all of these pieces together, we started with a bit of good news on the marine extinction front, that at least in the here and now, there is less extinction driven by humans in our oceans. If we cause ourselves and allow ourselves the opportunity to sort of think a little bit further forward, there's a lot of opportunity for us to push more biodiversity than we might like over an extinction cliff, taking us to a slightly scarier place. There do seem to be some fundamental shifts in the way that humans are using the oceans that may be related in important ways to the capacity to trigger a shift like that in the oceans. But there seem to be a lot of things on the tool bench, on the lab bench, on the workbench, tools and technologies that can help us look after our impact, study our impact, control our impact, and see that it manifests itself more responsibly in the oceans than it did on land. I mentioned that I grew up in Los Angeles, a much less pretty place than here. That's how I feel about Los Angeles, too. But those are the cards that you're issued. It's not a very wild place. It's easy to forget that in about 85 years, Los Angeles was a fairly biodiverse coastal ecosystem. And in 85 years, we went from a fairly biodiverse coastal ecosystem to something that looked like this. However, as a kid that wanted to get into the wild here, all I had to do was jump on this freeway, drive down to the oceans, put on a snorkel, dive underwater, and then I was in one of the most wild ecosystems on the planet. You know, in the company of 500-pound giant sea bass, of 50,000 or 10,000-pound great white sharks, and many-ton migrating gray whales, right? So there couldn't be a grander juxtaposition between the wildness of these two spaces. Now, I'm not suggesting in this dialogue about a industrial revolution in the oceans that in 85 years our oceans are going to go from looking like this to looking like this. That's not what I'm suggesting. What I'm suggesting is that things are changing in our oceans, that when we challenge ourselves to sort of think about a 100 or 200 year future of our oceans, a lot will change and is already changing the oceans. What I'm suggesting is that change may impact the future of extinction, may impact the future of biodiversity in our oceans in a big way. And I'm also suggesting that what happens to biodiversity in the oceans could feed back to impact our own future in a really big way. Let me leave that there, and I'm glad to field any questions.
one question for Doug, and then afterwards you're welcome to join us at Trisha and Ed's house with the address up there. So.
Cool. Sorry for running so long. I get excited. Questions are good over beer too, so that works. Yeah. Okay.
So I think of one system that isn't in your comparison that might be relevant to some of the things with the large movement and landscape, and that's avian systems.
Yeah.
And so have you thought about some of these questions in that sense and how they're affected? Because it is more of this almost patch dynamics where some areas are protected that they are in and some aren't.
Yeah. Seabirds are is that what you're thinking about? Marine?
Well, I was thinking of even just your migratory overland birds.
Right. Yeah. Right. So birds definitely have a presence, and in these vulnerability plots for extinction going forward, and they certainly interact in different ways with something like, so take seabird, for example. An industrial revolution, if it were to hit and change ocean habitats, it's because they're an interesting hybrid species where they're spending a lot of time feeding in the oceans, but they're basically residents of at least aerial space and nesting on land. Seabed mining may not impact them directly, but what's interesting to me when we sort of think about this history of like changing use of space is that seabirds are one of the most endangered groups of fauna on the planet. If you actually look at endangerment for seabirds, we all are sort of hyper aware that amphibians are screwed. They're in really bad shape because of a variety of reasons, including sort of the mass proliferation of this disease that we've at least in part helped move across our planet. Seabirds often are up there with vying for being one of the most at-risk groups on the planet. For me, that is a sort of delayed impact from things that we did on land, from modification of habitats and change, because they, if you think back to that plot of species that, as I said, sort of put a foot onto land, they because they end up interacting, nesting on islands, nesting on coastlines, that they may be in a higher risk category already because of the history of things that we've done to shape terrestrial habitats and are likely to sort of be more connected to the terrestrial story of how we've altered habitats and how that's altered risk and where they may sit in the near and far term for being a group of risk for extinction. In many ways, I think of them as folding more into the terrestrial story, into the marine story. It'd probably be good to keep going and talk more about that, but yeah, good question. I mean, there's, there'll be a range of ways that, depending on the way that you interact with different kind of habitats, that this story about terrestrial, or about marine industrial change will impact your own vulnerability in your future. But a good question.